It's my pleasure, it's my real great pleasure to introduce Myron Scholes.
Thank you, Carlos and Tony, for your kind introductions. When you're very old like I am, it takes a very long time to introduce one, so I'm not too tired. Solution to the first Black Scholes model. So it was do is try to garner a lot of experience to try to understand how nitty-gritties work. You know, when you are an academic and you look at the water from afar, it looks very calm. And when you get into it, you're doing something, you look really close at the water, it looks very turgid, very turgid. You know? So I always figured out that there must be some convex combination of the two, which would actually make the field of finance grow and also create an applied area that combines applications with theory. When I started out teaching, I didn't know what anything that we were doing would be applied to. So over time, by having the theory, having the vision of the water from afar, it was adopted in two tremendous areas. It was adopted in the area of investments, you know, that using technology, using science, using understanding of asset pricing and diversification and modeling came into being in that dimension. And I remember teaching practitioners about finance and quantitative technology, and that was one branch. And I went to Wells Fargo Bank in 1968 before I left to go to MIT, and I suggested that they start working on passive investment strategies, you know, instead of active management strategies, which later led to their development of the index fund and Barclays Global, Wells Fargo Barclays Global after that. So there's one strand, is that another area which came about in part because of the understanding of option technology and derivatives was setting up and trying to understand ways of changing the nature of the banking industry from being, when I was young and just started off, basically the banking industry or the broker-dealer community was just based on schmoozers. That's that you had their agents, you know, it's like they would have on the one hand you have a person who knew who wanted to buy bonds, and on the other hand you knew someone who wanted to sell bonds, and basically they married the two together. So the big thing was just having a Rolodex and being able to contact people. But that was not what finance was supposed to be. Finance was to be that the intermediation world, the community would set up a framework not to just marry people together, but to take positions and then understand the risks of their positions and be able to hedge those risks and actually compress time. And so all of the functions of finance that we talk about and know about are based on the fundamental idea of trying to compress time. And so if we learn how to compress time, there's progress to be made in figuring out how to make things faster and that is true not only in finance, but it's true in commerce generally. And so the things that we developed and worked on, the things that still need to be developed, are really embryonic because of the change in computing and telecommunication technology. As in addition to that, the ability of our theory to be expanded and to learn from the combination of theory and apply what we learn from actually being involved in the business itself. So today I'd like to talk a little bit about the intermediation process and managing under uncertainty. As Coase mentioned in his introduction, I have taught a course, or am teaching a course in to students at Stanford, where I talk about managing under uncertainty. Managing under uncertainty ideas that relate to uncertainty or managing under uncertainty or just simple questions about capital and how to put capital to work, how much capital to allocate to projects. Just a simple thing. We undertake net present value projects where we project cash flows into the future, we take expectations, we discount that to present value, and we take projects that have positive present value. We might also add real options, think about how to add some uncertainty to that. But the problem is that if we think of the opportunity set as changing, so at some subsequent time, capital is not available, or that it's the case that there's losses that are taken, and at those states in the world there are losses. What is the adjustment, and how does the adjustment work? So really, what capital is needed to provide liquidity for projects or provide staying power? And if we believe that the value of the human capital of teams that are running firms or running financial entities are not valuable, then we can think of finance as being the putty, clay, putty world. We start with putty, we make an investment decision at the end of the period, we get it back into putty, and we restructure, we go again. So just a sequence of IIP processes that are repeating. The interesting question is, what if it isn't, and how do we handle that? How do we make it alive? We have our teams, our value, our human capital that we want to preserve, and the like. And uncertainty has huge effects on labor capital trade-offs. The more uncertain we are about the future of evolution, then the more likely it is we want to use human capital, not physical capital, because of the cost of adjustment. Issues about who's attracted to various businesses. I remember reading Jared Diamond's book on guns and butter, and the idea that farmers were drove out hunters. You know, the hunters disappeared. The hunters disappeared because the farmers came in and routed them out. And where do the hunters go? Hunters go where the meat is, and hunters go where there's a lot of volatility and a lot of risk. That's where they go. And where do they go? They go to finance. They go to finance business. They go to academics. You're a hunter. You know, when I first started off, I gave me, when I went to MIT, a yellow pad of paper and a pen. And they gave me a piece of chalk. You know, they don't give you chalk anymore, but they gave me a piece of chalk. And they said, hunt, or teach and do research, you know. So you're attracted to an hunt and the like. And at the time, I had to develop all my own notes. And hunters steal from others. You know, they try to look at what others are doing. They try to look at their meetings, you know. And so under uncertainty, hunters do things that are different from farmers. So what type of businesses attract farmers? What type of businesses attract hunters? How do they glom on to ideas? They go to find my meat, and that's why I had to hide my research from Bob Merton for a period of time. I'm a Bob's very honest man, you understand. Or it's the case that basically I husband things or try to glom on to other people's work, and so that affects the whole intermediation business or affects finance just by the nature that people are attracted. Engineers are going to be attracted to steady businesses, and we have to realize in finance in a simple way that we are in a Goldilocks world, in a three-barrel world. You know, when it's the idea that volatility is no volatility in the economy, or no volatility at all, and the porridge is too cold. You know, the hunters get restless, and what we end up doing is having us create more risk in the system. The risk gets larger because we want to accentuate our returns, and we think we've understood the uncertainty around us. And then when the porridge is just right, intermediaries in our business, we make money. The turnover, the porridge is hot enough so that we make money. There's a lot of intermediation where people want our services from the intermediation business. And then, unfortunately, sometimes when the porridge is too hot, then money stops. Because basically what we have, in a fascinating way, is that we have everything in finance and the economy where there's volatility time. making money in a particular way, when things are too hot, you can't digest the information. And the interesting part of finance is it's the same thing. You have a friend, unfortunately, who has a heart attack. Time is too much volatility, too much uncertainty. There's no way at that moment of time to go to search the best cardiologist or figure out what hospital to go to, figure out how the rehab plan is going to work. No, you know, there's no time. Volatility is too great. So that time compresses, and that, in a lot of ways, time stops. Okay? So in finance, at times, time stops. And that time stopping, because it's the case that intermediaries don't know at that time how to intermediate anymore. They had a heart attack. Right, so basically having a heart attack, it needs time again to recalibrate the model, to restart the system, and to let it go from that particular point. And so we don't know, in the idea we have to, for sustainability or power, it's necessary to understand that those parts, that's how markets work. And why they work that way is we should have more research on. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. And the topics that we have, we need tremendous new research and additional research in understanding all of these issues. The capital allocation, how to allocate capital to strategies or investments, or how to think about capital structure in a more dynamic way than we're thinking about it, and how to handle capital structures. Obviously, debt is like a cancer. You know, you have to do something about it. It doesn't go away. If the value of assets falls, you have debt. If you don't adjust the debt you have, the risk goes up dramatically. It goes up, and it creates lots of non-linearities for the equity. If one wants to stay in business, it's necessary to figure out how to make those adjustments and what will happen in various states of the world where shocks occur, or the opportunity set changes, or transaction costs go up dramatically to adjust. And optimization tools, risk management firms or financial institutions are not risk minimization. They're not risk minimization. Risk is the other side of the coin of making returns or making money. And yet, financial institutions that I've dealt with and work with, the risk is a control and regulatory process and not really yet integrated into the decision-making in a firm. Neither is integrated into the corporations. That everyone in a corporation, board, group, or senior management wants to talk about returns or making money, the point estimates of the future. No one wants to talk about volatility or uncertainty and what will happen in times of crisis or shock, or what we can do to be proactive in protecting against that, or how do we react at the time and occurrence does occur. I have a concierge doctor, you know, he's supposed to be there. I've got a number. I have, unfortunately, some accident. He's supposed to know how to get me to where I'm supposed to go and know the problems I'm supposed to have. But it's costly to do that. And you know, the idea in investment when you run a firm is the question, fundamental question. Should you carry the umbrella if it looks like it might rain? If you carry the umbrella, buy that protection, buy the insurance, carry the umbrella, and it doesn't rain, your colleagues at dinner, your friends will say, what an idiot. You carry this umbrella around when it didn't rain. The converse is also true. If you don't carry the umbrella and it does rain, you get very wet. And so it's very expensive buying the umbrella. So those are trade-offs. You know, we have nothing in finance yet. There's really no theory, no. And it's just a wonderful idea to think about, in my view, of the idea of how much flexibility should we build into it. Obviously, if you're the postal person and you're walking around, you know, you're going to always wear your, have your rain slick and you're going to have your other weather gear. Why? Because, you know, it's your, that's your business. You know it's going to rain. But on the other hand, and so you protect yourself. But the problem is that deciding on how much flexibility, how much optionality to build into your operating programs and firms, or how much flexibility to build into the financing program, and how to is a business decision. It makes our field alive. It makes it really alive to think about uncertainty and what we know, and thinking about these issues as opposed to other things that we tend to talk about. So if you look at risk management, if it were the case that you're at the board of a firm, and you talk, and I went to the board of a company and I said that we are going to increase our profits by 30% by reducing our investment in our advertising budget, and we're going to grow sales by 41%, everyone would have myriad questions. They say, how can you do that? I mean, that doesn't make any sense. Then the risk officer comes to the board and says, the VAR, value of risk, is 100 million. No question. Let's go on to the next slide. So the idea, our goal, our job, is to make sure that risk is understood, that the idea of uncertainty becomes primary in the way people think about things, because it makes financial management it makes the field alive and part of the process that we're going to have to see in the future, that risk management is really brought forward, brought to the and made part of board understanding and board decision making. And so I think it's, and I talk about compensation policies and hunters, and I also, we have to have ex ante reporting systems, how to report risks, how to report uncertainty, and then how do we learn from it? What do we learn from what we have? The Dodd-Frank bill, I know you've talked about that a lot here. We had infrastructure that we had built over many, many years, and that infrastructure failed. You know, it failed maybe because of moral hazard reasons. We didn't want to look at it, or that infrastructure failed in lots of ways for other reasons. But the infrastructure failed. So instead of learning from why the infrastructure failed, how are we going to be able to fix it? What things are we going to be able to do to make learn from what we had? How can we change the bankruptcy laws? How can we change the reporting mechanism? How do we think about compensation policies? How should we think about regulatory policies and regulation? We said, no, let's throw out everything and start over again. So what have we learned? And those are the questions. So you learn from experience. You learn from what you do. You learn from mistakes. You grow from there. And if you don't want to accept failure, then that's silly. I mean, basically, you know, I've been a hunter. You know, I take risks. I lost in various things, and I made in various things. But that's life. So from failure, you learn things, and you learn how to go on, and it's a richer way to understand things. You're never going to prevent failures, because if you prevent failures, basically we have not, you know, it's like the research. You have good research papers and bad. If you only want to do a good research paper, you'll never do any research. There's many papers that I published that I thought were nothing, not very good. People really liked them, and other papers that I said were terrific. No, you know, so much. I mean, that's life. You got to keep going. So I think that there are three ways, in my view, to earn returns, and all have wonderful research possibilities to them. But one is holding systematic exposures that are priced in the market, and we hold inventory. The idea that someone has to hold the inventory of securities and that develop the whole area, including knowing nothing or index funds or funds or factors that happen to be priced in the market. But you know, we then have a lot of issues and research even in this area under uncertainty because of the idea that we know that the world is really not having a constant evolution of the factor returns. We know that, and obviously this crisis, the recent crisis showed that to the extreme, industry and in the idea of figuring out how to, what are systematic exposures, and that is a competitive rate of return, and one makes a competitive rate of return by doing that. The second area in which we make money is alphas, or predicting growth rates, discount rates, and doing it better than others. So it's really turning over inventory. You make money by holding inventory, how to hold that inventory, what ways to hold it, what are the risks or uncertainty of holding the inventory is an area. And the second area is turning over inventory. And I think of two ways to turn over inventory. One is proactively, I can forecast better than others that the cash flows of this company or the discount rates or whether stocks are going to outperform bonds. So that's the second way. It's being proactive in forecasting the future. Okay. And the third way is providing intermediation services to the market or risk transfer services, which is reactive. It's turning over inventory or holding inventory and reacting to the opportunity to make money. And I call this Omega, because Omega from Ohm's law, as the resistance in grows, or the resistance increases, the demand for intermediation services increases, and the intermediaries can reduce that clogging, or they reduce the increase the flow. So the idea is that intermediation is making markets work, and I will expand on that more here now. The modeling, just quickly, and I'm not going to spend very much time on this, is the idea of having in our world, what we have is just a very interesting phenomenon that I like to think of the analogy of children in the playground. So we see various clusters of kids. Some kids are playing ball in one part of the playground, and other children are in the sandboxes, or others are on the swings. And so we try to identify clusters in various ways. We identify clusters by using historical data, or we identify clusters by objects such as the swing, by making industry factors, or what other factors we tend to, big versus small, or you know, or book to market, or other types of factors that we think are risk factors. And we identify these as risk factors. The same way we identify clusters in the place. But the clusters are really an NP-complete problem. It's a computationally very difficult to, because there's so many combinations of the clusters to try to figure out exactly what the optimal clusters are. Even if you had very gigantic computers, it's most likely that you would fail and identify the correct clusters. But the interesting part about clusters with the children in the playground is all of a sudden children start moving. Okay, they start moving together. So the clusters that we thought existed start breaking down. So what is the attractor? What's the new manifold attractor that's attracting the student? We had a manifold before. We see this manifold. The manifold is our vision of the children in the playground and how they're situated, how they're moving together. And then there's a new attractor, a new manifold attractor. And what is it? What's making the children move in a direction? So maybe the attractor is an ice cream truck. You know, so the children are going to the ice cream truck. And then when they go to the ice cream truck or towards the ice cream truck, then we have interventions occurring. The teachers might say, no, no, get back into the playground. So the regulators are regulating the children. And then when the children leave the ice cream truck and come back, they don't go back to the same clusters they had before. New clusters are formed. So the idea of our thinking about intermediation or risk management or uncertainty is in this, the idea of the, we always felt that the path, or when the path is going to be the same as the path before, the children are going to go back to the same clusters and they're going to evolve. But there's nothing which says that the children are going to do that. In fact, we have interventions that start off on new paths. And so we have to think of what are the manifold attractors in a crisis, what creates the crises that cause the attractors to occur. We know in the system itself, are there things we can identify that are causing that we can react and know, yes, there was an ice cream truck that the children were attracted to, that changes the risk in the risk patterns, or can we think before the fact as ways to identify when an ice cream truck is coming, the bells we can hear, or things such as that. We know that in a system of intermediation, that what happens, that when the system is becoming unstable, because this is sort of like the tractors and like the butterfly effect, we have continuous evolution, or we have a jump, can we identify when attractors are causing this change to occur? And basically, if you look at the residuals of the process, we can look at mean reversion, and generally think things come back. But when things are getting noisy, they don't come back in the system. They go back, and they go away again, but they don't come all the way back. Volatility increases in the system. Volatility, the children are starting to move, you see much greater volatility. And shocks occur in one direction versus the other, which creates instability in the system. And so that leads you then exogenously to say, can we understand from the initia, things that would lead us then to look and act to understand more deeply what's happening in the system. So the issue that I'm saying is that there's no reason when we have individuals in the system that things are completely exogenous. You know, when I started finance and thought about finance, I thought of risk and uncertainty as completely exogenous. You know, I look, observe stock prices and returns, I compute it, you know, Chris data using that data, means, returns, volatility, uncertainty, beta, systematic factors, etc. But risk is not exogenous, risk is endogenous because we affect the risk in the system through wanting to adjust our holdings and portfolios asynchronously. And the idea that intermediaries come in to actually try to make things synchronous. And at times when all the kids are going to the ice cream truck, it's impossible. You know? So, so that all the various constraints and all the various activities that affect returns, individuals affect returns by their needs or their decisions. And only if intermediaries or outsiders can come in and completely negate what others want to do, then you will see the process immediately adjust to what it was before. But it's not going to immediately be that way when you have individuals involved in the underlying process. So I think that the intermediation business, or Omega, is to compress time. You know, there's a huge asynchronicity between, and asynchronicity is part of finance or part of business. There's demanders want something here, and intermediaries step in and carry the inventory forward in time until someone is going to step into the shoes of the ultimate buyer or the ultimate seller. My family was in the clothing business, department store business. We bought inventory, and then we sold that inventory out as people came into our stores later on. So we took the inventory risk. We could have had no inventory in our stores. We didn't have, not like modern day internet or bespoke everything. You know, we didn't have anything made to measure. We had took inventory risk. Why? Because the supply was at a different time than the demand. And so we were compressing time by intermediating those imbalances. And everything in the, as I said, the functions of finance do it. So that the interesting part about Omega or the intermediation business, that people in the finance world are willing to give up returns, to pay intermediaries to carry risk forward in the marketplace. That's different from maybe alpha world, where people are competing against each other to forecast better for the future. So just the idea of hedgers pay speculators, these are speculators in the classical sense of the word speculator, carrying the risk forward in time and being compensated for it. So the classic example is the miller buying the wheat from the farmer transfers associated with the week that week that's being held, including operational risk and local changes in demand or interest, and at the same time as generalized risks of factor risks. And so the miller can hold equity capital to cushion against all sources of risk, or the miller can decide to hedge risks or transfer risks that the miller has no expertise in to speculators who then would carry that risk forward. And the speculators expect to make money, in my view, for providing that service of carrying the risk forward in time, until such time as the bakers buy the flour to make the bread and cakes that we consume. So basically, the risk transfer mechanism is all parts of the chain are willing to pay others to carry risk forward. The same thing is true in all parts of finance and all parts of businesses that are intermediary businesses under uncertainty. It's all the same issue as to who's willing to pay for the risk transfer and the continuation of risk over time. And as a consumer can go and buy the wheat from the farmer directly that they're going to use for their bread and cakes, and do the reverse process. When they want the bread and cakes, they take the wheat to the miller mills it into flour, they take the flour then to the baker and do it, and get the cakes there. This is less expensive, you know, because they don't know their demands. And with asynchronicity and changes in what they want to do, they don't know whether they want to play in the sandbox or the ice cream truck or come back into a new group afterwards. So they're willing to pay for the risk transfer services because it's a transfer of the uncertainty. So we know in a business world, generalized risks in a business and there are idiosyncratic risks. To make money, it's necessary to concentrate. To make money, a business must concentrate and take risks. That business must concentrate, but it doesn't need necessarily to take generalized risks. So because it has no expertise in generalized risks, the issue fundamentally is it less expensive to hedge or transfer generalized risks or use equity or some forms of dynamic equity because of the need for additional capital at times when you need that capital, not a static equity, but thinking of a dynamic system to preserve what one has. And so I don't necessarily think derivatives or derivative products will survive or equity survive, or because it's an efficiency issue. What's the new innovations in finance that are going to occur? What are the new things that are going to occur which allows for the ability to compress time, as I said, the ability to transfer risk and understand risk because of the uncertain demands of consumers and what their tastes are going forward. So it's a rich area, but we will see, you know, and I think that these are the trade-offs generally. So I think basically there's, if I ask my students, if I ask everyone whether it's alpha is the way you make money, they will say, yes, I can pick deep value stocks, I can predict better than others, I'm smarter than anyone else, and I can make money. When I say, you can't make money that way because people are smart. It takes a lot of skills to be able to make money predicting the future. I don't want to predict the future. I want to predict the past. I want to be able to say, basically, if someone wants my services and willing to pay me for it, if I can understand the uncertainty of providing those services and reduce the asynchronicity and make money doing it, I want to do that. I want it to be the most boring business in the world. I want it to be the case that people are paying me all the time. My mother taught me that was the way to run a business. Make it boring, Michael. No excitement. Unfortunately, the case which you have to have excitement because of the uncertainty. So I think the sustainable business model to me is intermediation and asking the question, how do I get inside uncertainty? How do I understand the uncertainty in my business so I can know why I'm making money and why is the case that when I'm providing intermediation services in a business or in my bank or hedge fund or whatever, that how I'm making money. So the question is always, why am I making money? Not that I can predict the future better than others. So basically, when we think of risk transfer and the idea to take transfer risk, that we know, you know, the static definitions of risk transfer in the depth sense world where it's bid off or spread through one way to look at it. But the problem is that we have to think in the dynamic system. And they're dynamic, and the states of the world are very large. When you have rate diffusion, and information set is so gigantic, it's very hard to understand all the states of the world. How do you enumerate these states of the world? You know, there's a mighty uncertainty, or when you think of the Aaron-Boone model, you think of the Aaron-Boone model being able to specify all the states, and then you can price the state, or the Black-Scholes model, where you have two variables, either one state variable, which is the market, and the other state variable, which is the interest rate, and taking those two state variables, you can reproduce everything. That's great, but maybe the information set is broader than that, the dynamics of the math that I talked about So the state space is very tough. If you know the state space and you want to think about hedging risks on the downside, and obviously a put option is a very nice contract because it protects your downside, so you can have provide liquidity automatically for yourself. The interesting problem is if you can't specify the form of the option you want, how much protection you want, it makes it very difficult. Once you can do that, tell me the form, when you want it, that I can price it. Or you can price it, but we can price it. But the point is, if you don't know that, it makes it very difficult. And then additionally, the problem becomes one of endogeneity. I can have a plan to protect myself against uncertainty, and my plan might be perfect. The problem is, I have to also take account of what everyone else's plans are in the system. How do I aggregate all the risks? If everyone in your city says, I can sell my house in 3 months, and then everyone wants to sell their house, you can't sell your house in 3 months. So how do we think in our society of aggregating these risks or these demands or these uncertainties so that decision making can be made so that we can understand the aggregation of risks? You know, and I talked about volatility, and I think we don't know in our society the correct level of volatility to make us cautious enough. You know, if I said when the porridge is too cold, and we dampen volatility, there's a tendency because of our Bayesian incomplete priors and our beliefs to reaffirm our beliefs by using past data. All science is inductive and then deductive. We're all data mining. You can't do things really from first principles. We learn from recent experience, we learn from the past. So if we observe that things are quiescent, non-volatile, then we think, oh, we can take more risk because the world is tame, the tiger is tame, you know, it's sleeping there, it's having a good time, it's sitting nicely, and, you know, and how do I know? I think the tiger's tame, maybe the tiger just well fed. And so we end up in a situation where we try to dampen risk, whether the Fed Reserve wants to dampen risk, or whether the government wants to say the economy is going to be growing, there's no risk involved. So as a result, people react. They don't do nothing. They react. They take more risk. And if they take more risk, then if you're wrong, we're wrong that the tiger is only well fed, then we have too much risk. We have too much leverage, we have too much, no flexibility. We tell people to take human capital decisions, and when uncertainty unfolds, they have no alternative use. So we don't tell people to read the classics. You know, I study Greek. Now, I don't know why, but I guess I'm maybe a broader person. So the, you know, we don't know the correct level of volatility in our society. And we know that we have to think about how to do that. So what is the intermediation business? You know, I've been thinking a lot about this and businesses in general, but intermediation really is trying to think about what equilibrium values are, you know, what high bar is, what the equilibrium profits are. And then when your opportunity to make profits, you know, price times quantity minus the cost of producing that quantity is profits. And I have lambda is the decay factor. So this is like an Ohlenbeck, once the Ohlenbeck process or the
elastic random walks. Most of the things we think about, if you think about a random walk, is that really lambda is equal to zero, so that just basically you have profits are competitive and they'll fluctuate right way around with a DZ, a draw from the earn with sigma, so that, you know, if you add your volatility of your profit. But you can have a system where lambda is not equal to zero, that an intermediary intermediates and is making a profit because they're providing speculative services, and as long as they can produce and earn a profit by buying cheaply and then holding it until it comes back to equilibrium value at rate lambda, then we have intermediation. So an intermediary has to have a fixed point. When I say turning over inventory or holding inventory, we're trying to buy inventory here and sell it here, given what we think is the decay factor. It could be very fast, so you could have high-speed frequency trading, doing it over a very short period of time, or lambda is very short, but very repetitive, many, many times from the earn are you drawing. Or you can have it over a longer period of time, where basically before things come back to equilibrium. So the point is that intermediaries will step in once they have a fixed point and be able to undertake velocity. But you need a fixed point to intermediate. You need a fixed point to be able to change your portfolio. Because if otherwise, it's very hard to have velocity or turnover, unless you're not going to buy something unless you know it's cheap. And why it's cheap, and how much capital to put against that, how to scale into the position. Okay. Now the problem is that in our system is from time to time, we lose our definition of lambda and pi r and sigma. We don't any longer have an anchor or a feeling about what the equilibrium values are. And when that happens, you have a trembling hand equilibrium. Because when that happens, then you end up in a situation where capital market intermediaries or corporations can't intermediate anymore. The volatility is too great. Until they know where the kids are going to go back into the playground from after the ice cream truck, then it's the case that it's very hard for them to intermediate. So they withdraw capital until once again you get a new fixed point. Once again you get a new anchors and know how things are going to happen. So today, in my view, the reason intermediation is not great in the banking and financial world and corporations are not intermediating by having confidence about the future is because of the shock created a need to find a new fixed point and a new way of thinking about how velocity is going to occur. I call this really, I call this sort of the Heisenberg uncertainty principle of finance. That basically, speculators withdraw capital at the time they no longer have faith in the intermediation business until they can breathe again, find these fixed points and have confidence in the changes and realize why people are paying them for their service. So decision time stops and they rationally withdraw capital and volatility increases. So I think of really finance is sort of like a man and a dog. You know, we have the man is walking the dog. And the man is a rational actor, having the fixed points, knowing where the path is. And as the dogs pull themselves away and they're willing to pay for services, the man makes money by pulling the dogs back on the path. So all the behavioral finance people, they're the dogs. You know, I'm trying to understand what the dogs do. But if it's the case, if that's not the majority, that's a real part of the world. So if it's the case that the dogs are pulling the man away from the path, and then the man pulls the dog back, so the behavioral finance people need the man. Because without the man, if the man is not there, where do the dogs go? You know, what causes the equilibrium to come back into the system? So the behavioralists need the rational guy and be able to intermediate. From time to time, because of shocks or something untoward, what happens? The leash breaks, right? And then the dogs are all over the place. and the man is chasing the dogs. Now, you can't distinguish the men from the dogs because they're trying to do, you know, you just can't, you don't know the differences. So there's no equilibrium in the system, and things become very chaotic until the dogs are back on the leash. But once the dogs are back on the leash, the new equilibrium path is different again because the man doesn't pull the dogs back to where he was before and start over again as nothing happened. So the whole new evolution occurs at that particular moment in time, which makes it fascinating. And unlike central bankers who say, from Bagehot on, who said the central bank shall lend money to intermediaries and banks based on good collateral. What is good collateral? Because it's not really a liquidity system or just a temporary reversion back to where it was before. What it really is that there's a valuation issue and a liquidity issue, both simultaneously. In fact, the bonds that are being bought now by the central bankers in Europe, they're not providing liquidity. Those bonds are going to be on their books for 30 years. So what's the difference between buying bonds for liquidity or otherwise? So that's very interesting. And one last thing is just the time the demanders of liquidity are willing to pay more for liquidity services, and they want to acquire an option after the fact. Again, being proactive or reactive. If the time of shocks or when the intermediaries can intermediate, that's exactly when the demand for insurance is greatest. And if you have to get a demand for insurance, then basically what happens, the intermediation stops just when the demand increases. And correlations among asset classes increase dramatically as speculators and hedgers attempt to transfer risk, but to whom? You know, they're all chasing the dogs and looking like the dogs. So time expands. Finance, time compresses, and at time expands. And the time expanding is the natural part of how markets work. So the business choices of being reactive and proactive, I said, lead us to the question of saying, how do markets work under uncertainty? Do they work as they work from, say, 2000 to 2007, or do they work as 2007 in combination with what happens in 2008 to 2012? So markets don't always work, because don't be bad Bayesians and looking at recent experience and say, that's how markets should work. So we want to get back to where we were. That's not how markets work. Markets always work as a combination of the two. So I think I'll stop there. And I know there are drinks coming, which are